Hello, I'm Dr. Maria Corcoran from the University of Washington. In this Hepatitis C online mini-lecture, I will review the American Association for the Study of Liver Disease and the Infectious Diseases Society of America's Simplified Treatment Algorithm for Hepatitis C virus. In this talk, I will provide a brief overview of the Simplified Treatment Algorithm for Hepatitis C, including who is eligible, review the pre-treatment assessment, outline the recommended direct-acting antiviral or DAA regimens for patients being treated under the simplified algorithm, review common drug-drug interactions for the recommended DAA regimens, and outline recommended on-treatment and post-treatment laboratory evaluation. Direct-acting antivirals have revolutionized the treatment of hepatitis C, allowing for shorter, safer, and more effective treatment. In an effort to simplify and streamline treatment for hepatitis C, the American Association for the Study of Liver Disease and Infectious Diseases Society of America Hepatitis C Guidance Committee has devised a simplified treatment approach for hepatitis C, which streamlines the pre-treatment assessment and the recommended DAA regimens. This simplified approach is suitable for most patients who are treatment naive, including those without cirrhosis and those with compensated cirrhosis. The simplified approach can be used regardless of hepatitis C genotype. Patients are not eligible for this simplified approach if they have previously received hepatitis C treatment, have decompensated cirrhosis, co-infection with hepatitis B, are currently pregnant, have known or suspected hepatocellular carcinoma, a history of liver transplantation, or have compensated cirrhosis with concurrent end-stage renal disease. For patients who qualify for the simplified treatment algorithm, the American Association for the Study of Liver Disease and Infectious Diseases Society of America guidance recommends first calculating a FIB-4. For the purposes of the simplified treatment assessment, a patient is presumed to have cirrhosis if their FIB-4 score is greater than 3.25, or if they have a prior FibroScan stiffness of greater than 12.5 kilopascals, other non-invasive serologic tests above published proprietary cutoffs, clinical evidence of cirrhosis based on imaging, laboratory evaluation or exam, or a prior liver biopsy confirming cirrhosis. Prior to treatment, providers should also review the patient's current medications, including over-the-counter medications, assess for drug-drug interactions, educate the patient on proper administration of medications, medication adherence, and prevention of reinfection, as well as perform appropriate pre-treatment laboratory assessment. A complete blood count, hepatic function panel, and calculated glomerular filtration rate should be obtained within 6 months of starting hepatitis C treatment for persons without cirrhosis and within 3 months of starting treatment for those with compensated cirrhosis. All persons should have a quantitative hepatitis C RNA, HIV antigen antibody test, and hepatitis B surface antigen performed at any time prior to treatment. Persons capable of becoming pregnant should undergo serum pregnancy testing and counseling regarding pregnancy risk of hepatitis C medications prior to initiating treatment. There are two equally recommended direct-acting antiviral options for use in simplified treatment of persons with chronic hepatitis C. One, an 8-week treatment course of oral glecaprevir/pibrentasvir, and two, a 12-week treatment course with oral sofosbuvir/velpatasvir. Both of these regimens have pangenotypic activity, have once-daily dosing, are well-tolerated, and have cure rates greater than 95% with all genotypes. Glecaprevir/pibrentasvir is the first pangenotypic NS3-4A protease inhibitor and NS5A inhibitor combination to be approved that offers a potent treatment option for the vast majority of patients with chronic hepatitis C. This drug is not an option for patients with decompensated cirrhosis given the presence of a protease inhibitor. In the main registration trials for treatment-naive individuals, sustained virologic response rates for 8 weeks of glecaprevir/pibrentasvir were in the range of 95% or greater, with very few, if any, on-treatment virologic breakthroughs or post-treatment relapses. The University of Liverpool has an easy-to-use, up-to-date online drug-drug interaction database that is very helpful when reconciling a patient's medications and identifying drug-drug interactions. It can be helpful, though, to remember a few common interactions that frequently come up in clinical practice. One of the most common interactions encountered with glecaprevir/pibrentasvir is the interaction with statins. Glecaprevir/pibrentasvir increases the plasma concentration of statins and can increase risk for myopathy, including rhabdomyolysis. Glecaprevir/pibrentasvir can also increase levels of ethanol estradiol when these drugs are co-administered, leading to increased risk for ALT elevation. Finally, glecaprevir/pibrentasvir is contraindicated with certain HIV antiretroviral therapy, including protease inhibitors and pharmacologic boosters such as ritonavir and cobicistat, which can increase serum concentrations of glecaprevir. Similarly, glecaprevir/pibrentasvir should not be co-administered with select NNRTIs, including efavirenz and etravirine, which can decrease plasma concentrations of glecaprevir/pibrentasvir. Sofosbuvir/velpatasvir is a pangenotypic NS5A/NS5B inhibitor single-pill combination regimen that has potent activity against hepatitis C. In contrast to glecaprevir/pibrentasvir, it can be used safely in patients with decompensated cirrhosis as it does not contain a protease inhibitor. In the main registration trials, SVR12 rates for treatment-naive individuals were in the range of 95% or greater, with very few, if any, on-treatment virologic breakthroughs or post-treatment relapses. The most common drug-drug interaction seen with sofosbuvir/velpatasvir is an interaction with proton pump inhibitors, or PPIs. Co-administration of PPIs and sofosbuvir/velpatasvir is not recommended, as this leads to decreased plasma concentrations of sofosbuvir/velpatasvir. H2 receptor antagonists may be co-administered with sofosbuvir/velpatasvir as long as the doses do not exceed doses comparable to famotidine 40 mg twice daily. To summarize, glecaprevir/pibrentasvir and sofosbuvir/velpatasvir are both dosed daily, with the duration of glecaprevir/pibrentasvir being 8 weeks for persons on the simplified treatment algorithm, and the duration of sofosbuvir/velpatasvir being 12 weeks for persons on the simplified treatment algorithm. Glecaprevir/pibrentasvir should be administered with food and cannot be given to people with decompensated cirrhosis, while sofosbuvir/velpatasvir can be given with or without food and is safe in people with decompensated cirrhosis. Both are safe for use in renal impairment and do not require adjustments even in patients on hemodialysis. Notable drug-drug interactions with glecaprevir/pibrentasvir include those with statins, certain birth control pills, and select HIV medications, while the most common drug-drug interactions with sofosbuvir/velpatasvir is that with proton pump inhibitors. Most patients who qualify for the simplified treatment algorithm will not need any on-treatment monitoring. Due to the risk for symptomatic hypoglycemia in patients taking medications for diabetes concurrently with direct-acting antivirals, persons on diabetes medication should undergo routine blood sugar monitoring. Similarly, patients on warfarin should be informed of the potential for changes in their anticoagulation status while on DAA therapy and undergo INR monitoring for subtherapeutic anticoagulation. Although the risk of liver decompensation during DAA therapy is rare, clinicians may choose to monitor liver function tests in patients with compensated cirrhosis while on hepatitis C treatment. When done, this monitoring typically occurs monthly. Finally, all patients should have repeat hepatitis C RNA and liver function testing performed 12 weeks following the completion of hepatitis C therapy to evaluate for hepatitis C cure and normalization of transaminase levels, respectively. To learn more about hepatitis C, please check out our online hepatitis C curriculum, which contains a variety of lessons, cases, and slides to reinforce your knowledge. Thanks for joining me today.
The production of this hepatitis C online mini lecture was supported by funding from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.